Saturday afternoon is always a marathon program, especially from 1 to 3 when we're talking matters sports. Ahead of, you know, the European leagues, which are resuming after international break. And of course, tonight it's a late kickoff fixture pitting Arsenal, playing host to Liverpool in what's expected to be a mouth-watering game. Of course, that will be forming the basis for our discussion this afternoon as we almost get to the tail end of the program until 3 p.m. But before we do, let's talk about the headlines of the week. One of them, Sergio Kun Aguero, the Argentine international, announcing his departure from Manchester City. And of course, Ken Andrew is still on the show, and joining us is, you know, big man himself, Eric. Good to see you, Eric. But how have you been?
I've been good, thank you.
You all right?
I'm good, I thank God.
So Ken, Sergio Kun Aguero, he announced his departure from Manchester City. He has given, you know, his unwavering services to the Etihad based team, of course winning a few titles with them and encountering challenges, injuries being one of them. But what do you remember Sergio Kun Aguero for?
A lot of people remember him for that goal he scored to clinch the league on the last day against QPR in 2012. It was a crazy goal, and I think that just skyrocketed his fame and popularity in the league. People started looking more at Aguero, and he didn't fail them. He lived up to their expectations. When you look at the top goal scorers in the league over the past 7-8 seasons, he's always close to the top, third, fourth there. He always gets crucial goals for City, and he's been one of the greatest strikers, not just in the Premier League or at City, but in the whole world in football. He's been of great service to City over his years there.
Sure. Since his announcement that he will leave Manchester City at the end of the season for the undisclosed club, there has been, you know, argument on social media platforms, especially Twitter, coming from football lovers who think that Sergio Kun Aguero is the best striker to have ever graced English Premier League. Sort of debatable, but he comes close.
We cannot say maybe he's the best because we have the likes of Thierry Henry, who also did really well in the Premier League. We have the likes of Wayne Wazaruni, and what we'll do, we'll rank him among the top five. The top five in the Premier League strikers, he will be there. Now the order is where the debate begins.
Now, we saw what Jamie Carragher did, the pundit for Sky Sports and former defender for Liverpool. Of course, he did his best 10 strikers to have graced English Premier League. And he started with Thierry Henry, the French legend, followed by Sergio Aguero, the Argentine international, who announced his departure from Manchester City. And he one Alan Shearer, the legend, who played for Newcastle, came in third, and I think Didier Drogba fourth, Wayne Rooney five. I don't know. As per your list, which one will you go with?
When it comes to the strikers and finishers, I'll begin with Thierry Henry. I'll throw Ruud van Nistelrooy in that mix, because he was a ruthless finisher. We're not talking about a best player, we're talking about a finisher. And we look at, we have Sergio Aguero. In terms of finishing, he was a big game player. And personally, I'll never forgive him for that goal he scored against QPR, that under Man City in the league, being a Manchester United fan. And you can see what kind of a player he was. And then we have Wayne Rooney Oaza in terms of finishing. But in terms of contribution to the game in general, then Wayne Rooney will come as number one, because Wayne Rooney was a fighter.
Because he's a player who was played out of position. He was
most of the time
not prominently a centre forward, playing at 9 or 10, sometimes on the flank, and his immense contribution.
And he sacrificed himself so much to let Cristiano shine. You look at Wayne Rooney, he sacrificed himself so much to let Ruud van Nistelrooy shine and such kind of things. So generally as a player, then Wayne Rooney will be slightly ahead of Aguero. But as a finisher, Aguero in a tight spot, he will finish.
Ken, your sentiments, do you read from the same script with him?
Yeah, not with Jamie Carragher. Obviously, he was going to put Rooney fifth. You don't have to say much.
Because of rivalry, United Liverpool.
Exactly. Yeah. But I'd agree with him on Thierry Henry as top, because You look at the five seasons he had a golden boot at Arsenal, and he was very key in their team, the Invincibles, in the really great Wenger teams. He was a really great player. And Aguero second, because the near post finishes, you know, you give him the ball in a tight spot, he turns, he shoots. He was a crazy finisher, and someone who I think maybe is not in the top five, but, and he didn't have longevity in the Premier League, but Luis Suarez was also a ruthless finisher when he was at Liverpool. He didn't have the longevity the others had in the league, but I'd still put him in my top 10 because of what he did, you know. He scored a lot of crucial goals. And also, I think if we are having this conversation 5 years from now, number one on the list is Harry Kane if he stays in the Premier League, because he's a fantastic striker, one of the best ever.
Now, let's delve into the possible replacement for Sergio Kun Aguero. We've seen Pep Guardiola in his pre-match conference saying that, you know, they are very comfortable with the academy players they have and the current squads. Maybe insinuating that Gabriel Jesus is up to the task. I don't know, playing mind games, because there is no way you can get away without replacing Sergio Aguero, who has been in formidable form.
Yeah, you've seen when Sergio Aguero has not been playing, you've seen how Man City are not winning as many games as when he plays. They don't score as many goals as when he's on that field. Gabriel Jesus may be a talent, may be a potential, but he's not yet there. He's not somebody you'd compare with Kun Aguero. And if Man City doesn't replace Kun Aguero, next season they will suffer. That is the reality. And I think Guardiola is just playing mind games, because you've seen Haaland being mentioned as Romelu Lukaku as potential replacement for that. Because you will not rely on a Sterling. Because you not rely on Jesus, you not rely on these kids who are coming up. You need an experienced finisher. Look at what happened to Manchester United. The moment they sold Lukaku without replacing Lukaku, what happened? There are games that Rashford will not finish as Lukaku would have finished, because Aguero was experienced, was lethal, and he was clinical. And those are the people, those are the qualities you need in a striker. And Aguero, despite the fact that he spent most of the time with injuries, he still finished among the top scorers. What if he stayed the whole season without an injury? He would score very many goals. And not only just goals, you know, there are goals a striker scores when you've scored 5-0, a striker scoring 2, but crucial goals. 1-0 that wins your game. I saw one, there was a game they played against Manchester United, and he passed Rio Ferdinand as if Ferdinand was standing. And he scored 1-0 and he won the game. You see, that's what you need in a striker. So they will have to replace.
I think the same sentiments were quoted from Pep Guardiola when Vincent Kompany, you know, his stay at Manchester City came to an end. And he said that, you know, they had other defensive options and they wouldn't be going to the transfer market. But we've seen City signing a lot of defenders, Ruben Dias, Nathaniel Ake, though not regularly getting played. Is there a need for Aguero to be replaced up front if they have to continue sharpening their attacking department?
Yeah, there is total need, because if you look at the positions where City's goals have been coming from, it's either playing Gundo or KDB as a false nine or as an advanced midfielder. Jesus does not really have that Aguero finishing, you know, that really crucial, that when you need him most, he's there with a goal. And they will go into the market. One thing that everyone can be sure about is City splashing money. I think they'll get a big player to replace Aguero, because if you don't replace him, it will be tough for them next season. With Jesus alone, they need to get a top striker to replace another top striker. That's how it works. Yeah.
Let's speak about another development. Leicester City striker Kelechi Iheanacho. At some point, he was a fringe player when Jamie Vardy was regularly getting played as a centre forward. But of late, he's been in scintillating form. He was voted as player of the month, and so is, you know, Chelsea's tactician Thomas Tuchel, being voted as the manager of the month. I don't know, deserving awards, deserving accolades for the two?
Yeah, deserving accolades for the two, especially for the Leicester player, because credit has to go to Brendan Rodgers. Brendan Rodgers has managed to play the two of them up front. Remember, the previous managers could prefer only Vardy up front, and that's why now Iheanacho could now look at him as a fringe player. But you see, Brendan Rodgers has found a system whereby both of them can complement one another. Iheanacho is good on the ball. Vardy has the speed, so he's good on the ball. Iheanacho can hold the ball and wait for Vardy to make that run. And that has helped the team and has improved his play. And last month, he scored some crucial goals. He scored a hat-trick. He scored the goal against Manchester United, knocking them out of the FA. Those are crucial goals. He deserves to be the player of the month, in my opinion. For Tuchel, he has brought calm into the Chelsea dressing room. Because that is one thing that Lampard was not able to do, and he has involved all the players. You remember when Lampard was there, there were some players who were sidelined, the likes of Rudiger, the likes of Azpilicueta, and they were not being used. But Tuchel has found a way in which he can use all the players, and everybody is happy. And that's why Chelsea has performed, because he had some crucial games that nobody expected him to knock Atletico Madrid out of the Champions League. Mm. And he has done that. So he also deserves it.
Ken,
yeah.
You know, in the past, I think during the era of managers like Sir Alex Ferguson, Arsene Wenger, those are the guys who used to play 4-4-2. Nowadays, the formation has quite changed, and the current managers don't prefer 4-4-2, unlike what Brendan Rodgers is doing at Leicester. Mm-hmm. And now, do you think him getting paired alongside Jamie Vardy, who is now also aging, has tried to revive his career that looked like it was coming towards the end?
Yeah, I think it's really great for him to play with a striker of Vardy's quality, because you know, you learn from the best when you're with the best. And also, with him playing with Vardy, we've seen a sort of roles changing. You know, Vardy these days, he gets more assists than goals. You know, he's helping Iheanacho improve his game. And he's really stepped up and he's really played well in the past games. The past month, you know, you look at their showing in the FA Cup against Man United. It was totally amazing, you know, for someone who had lacked game time over a long period of time to come in 2-3 months and play the way he's playing and still be on the rise. It's really amazing. And I think there's still more to come from him, because I don't think Leicester still have their James Maddison is ready yet. I think we'll still see a lot of him up front with Vardy in the 4-4-2.
Thomas Tuchel has been a revelation since joining Stamford Bridge. They're yet to lose even a single fixture, yeah. And they've been in high flying form.
Yeah, they have, especially when he said Atletico Madrid. That was crazy. No one expected that, because we knew Atletico, what they were going to do, and they do it so well, you know. And Chelsea were able to break them and win an aggregate 3-0 against Atletico Madrid. You know, those are a lot of goals to score against Simeone's side. And also, they've been playing really well. This squad selection, there are not a lot of changes, you know. Hudson-Odoi has come in, and guys like Rudiger have come in and they are performing well. Christensen, when he's been put in the middle since Thiago Silva got injured, he's been performing really well, and there's sort of calm in the camp. The Chelsea fans are really falling in love with Tuchel's styles, you know. And I think it's really great for them, because they have a young squad. Mason Mount, Reece James, Pulisic, they're young guys who need a coach like Tuchel to really excel, and it will help them a lot.
And my goodness, have you seen Mason Mount during international break for England? He's been exceptional. And we've seen how the likes of Gary Lineker, former internationals for England and also played for Leicester and Barcelona, you know, heaping a lot of praise on the young kid, because we thought he was phenomenal during Frank Lampard's tenure, when people used to say that, you know, he was sort of the son to Frank Lampard, how he used to give him, you know, a lot of priority, much consideration. But the kid is amazingly talented.
The kid is big talent, and credit has to go to Frank Lampard, because when even Frank Lampard was being criticized that he's picking him because he's English, he stuck by the kid. Yeah. But the talent and the potential is there. And one thing about that makes him really stand out is that he does his trade effortlessly. He does it so effortlessly that you'll not even notice him. And then after the game, you'll not even notice him. Look at the way his hairstyle is normal. There's not that hype. You see, if, I was just picturing if he's an African kid who is excelling like that. You'll see a mohawk and what kind of...
Yeah,
look at him.
A lot of
he's
highlights.
So humble, and he just goes about and does his business.
Yeah.
And that is what will make him a great player. And if he continues like that, then the English team will be built around him. He may be the Steven Gerrard of the future. You see, everybody was expecting that when Thomas Tuchel will come in, he will sideline Mount. But he put him on the bench for one game. Thereafter, he came in as a substitute. And then I remember Tuchel saying he realized how great this young man is. And since that time, he's been playing every game. So there's a very, very big potential for him in future. The discipline he has is amazing.
And talking about Mason Mount during international break, during this window where several teams were looking to secure slots for, you know, either World Cup or Euro 2020, which was postponed due to COVID-19 pandemic. I don't know, which one did you catch the attention? Because a lot was happening, and we saw even surprises and upsets. Germany,
yeah.
Of all the teams.
Yeah, I think that one's the one which caught a lot of people, because North Macedonia and Germany, you know, Germany is a footballing giant, like top players from everywhere, you know. The competition within their national team is just immense. And you look at North Macedonia and... they're never being, although they beat them, they're never on the same level with Germany. You know, it was a fluke, yeah, to be honest, because Germany also missed sitters and they were at their clinical best, you know. And that's football for you. You miss your chances, they score theirs. And that's it. That was the game which it made a lot of people happy.
Can we say that, you know, Joachim Löw's tactics and his style of coaching is sort of old-fashioned, and probably it's high time he looks for a challenge elsewhere?
He's exiting,
because he's overstayed.
He's exiting.
Yeah,
he's exiting.
He said he's exiting.
Yeah. And also, I think, you know, he said he's never selecting Müller during his time, or Mats Hummels. And there are players who could have been in the squad. They would have really helped, because Müller is a top guy, and he's still got gas. He's still got years to burn. So why not have him in the squad? That was
but
shocking.
Maybe for Mats Hummels is justified, because they have a lot of alternatives at the back.
Yeah, but you know, sometimes...
Or experience is key.
Experience is key. You look at how guys like Thiago Silva bring calm in the defense. You know, Ramos, when he's coming back from Madrid, you know, everything changes. They don't get knocked out of the Champions League.
Yeah, Pepe in Porto.
Pepe in Porto. You see, experience and those big-name defenders, those ones who've done it years and years, they're key, they're crucial.
I don't know whether you guys saw some report by Bleacher... reports where, you know, they had highlighted Portugal as one of the national teams that has got, you know, assembled a quality squad. Because if you look at the players who are starting as first 11 and those on the bench, it's huge depth.
They have immense depth, and I looked at that squad.
Can we say this is their time for
this
now rising to the mantle and probably win World Cup in Qatar 2022?
Oh yes, they have what
because
it takes.
Because they've always been coming close.
They have what it takes, eh? And one thing I liked about them is that despite the depth, because I looked at each position as three
yes,
quality players.
Yes.
Three quality players. And those three quality players are staggered edgewise. We have a forward who is Cristiano Ronaldo. We have Joao Felix. Yeah. You see, Joao Felix will learn from Ronaldo.
Yeah.
Ronaldo has been there, has done all that. They have also Jota.
Yeah.
And you look at these qualifiers, Jota has really scored. He scored 6 goals in total in the last few qualifiers. And one thing that the squad has is the fighting spirit. Most of the games they played, they concede first.
Yeah.
And then they go on and win. and you saw the other one which their goal was stolen by the referee, which made Cristiano become mad and throw the armband on the ground. I think this is their time. At one given time, I was thinking they're overrated, but they've proved themselves. We have Belgium, we have Portugal, and those are teams. We have France. Yeah. Those are teams to look out for because of the potential and the depth.
Now let's get into the match day. Liverpool up against Arsenal tonight. You know, a lot of fans had missed English Premier League because to them, international break is sort of boring. And now Premier League is back and a lot of matches are lined up this particular afternoon. City up against Leicester, quite a crunch game. And tonight, Arsenal up against Liverpool. You are telling me off air that, you know, you are rooting for Liverpool.
Yeah, Liverpool and City.
And you see, as a Man United fan, but rooting for Liverpool, quite a strange move.
Because, you know, Arsenal, I don't want Arsenal to be in the top seven or top six for some reason. But for City, the other game, I want Leicester to lose from a United's perspective because they're really close to us, you know, number two. And we want to finish second because City has already run away this thing. So second is the best position for United now. And Leicester losing will be a big boost to them because they have an easier game tomorrow at home against Brighton. So Leicester loss and Liverpool win, that's all we want.
How possible is that? Because before the international break, Arsenal looked like they were very convincing.
One, I think Arsenal may pull a surprise against Liverpool for three reasons. One, the Liverpool squad is aging. If you look at the average age is 29-30. If you look at, I was looking at their squad, the probable lineup. Nine of the players are above 29 years who are expected to start. That is one. Arsenal have exciting young people coming in, young kids coming in. Saka, who has really been good. There's Smith Rowe, who has really been good. There's the other left back, I think Tini, who has also really been good. And then secondly, the fact that Arteta has a way when he's playing against the established managers, he gets some, most of the time he gets his tactics right. He's beaten Man City, he's beaten Liverpool, he's given a headache to Chelsea, he's given problems to Manchester United. So the way he's going to set up his team today will give Liverpool problems. And thirdly, Liverpool have a midweek game against Real Madrid.
Yeah,
and that is the only.
So they will tend to spend most of their regulars.
That's the only true way of getting a trophy this season, or playing in the Champions League next season. So he may tend to think, the Premier League is gone. He's not gonna win it. The top four is tricky for him. So the only way to get into the Champions League next season is to win the Champions League. So he has a lot of balancing to do between today and now. Wednesday or Tuesday when they play Real Madrid.
Injury concerns for both sides, because Liverpool, we can attribute their shaky start to Premier League due to a lot of their influential players on the sidelines because of injury. I don't know, going into this particular clash.
Yeah, I've seen Firmino will be back. Yeah, he's back from injury. And I think the one they'll always miss is Virgil van Dijk and Joe Gomez and Matip, because the other defenders who've come in, they're not quite on their level, you know. They have done to a certain extent well, especially in the Champions League. Nat Phillips and Ozan Kabak, they looked great without a Fabinho in there, without a Matip in there. They looked great as a two. But in the Premier League, they keep making small mistakes, which usually cost Liverpool the game. So I just think they really miss a proper centre-back partnership, Van Dijk and Joe Gomez. And if they can get them back fit during this small period and have them for the start of next season, it will be a really big boost for them. And for Arsenal, I think David Luiz will miss the game. I think for Arsenal, whoever steps in into the centre-back position, just same, you know. he's not here, this guy will do the same job or make similar mistakes, because that is never their strongest position. They prefer their forwards are their best players, guys like Saka, Auba, though he's been underperforming, Lacazette. Yeah, so the defence for Arsenal, it's just...
And talking about the underperformance of their... You know, captain who was left out of the team in their last game before international break. Yeah. And Lacazette has been stepping up. But do you think Mikel Arteta should emulate on Brendan Rodgers and play the two? In partnership up front?
The two are good, and if they're played up front, they have different attributes. Eh? Lacazette can hold the ball and bring the other players into the game. Aubameyang has a tendency to look out for that killer pass. When he's given that killer pass, he's able to convert. But he's been having a problem, and I liked what Arteta did last time when he left him out of the team. And
because he arrived late?
Yes, and he went ahead and won the game. So you see, he sent a statement to these other kids. If I can leave out your captain, so you have to step up. You see, that's how you enforce discipline.
Yeah.
And I think it's really, he has now to prove himself in this game if he's given a chance. And they'll be looking out to be given a chance to prove himself. Which, given a chance, if they are given the two of them with Saka behind them, they'll give Liverpool problems. Looking at the Liverpool defense, that is shaky with those two young men. If they play the two teenagers, these two experienced strikers will give them a lot of problems.
How did he fare during international break, of course, for Gabon in 2021 African Cup of Nations qualifier? I think that would set the pace for performances of some of these players, even Mo Salah for Liverpool against Arsenal tonight, because against Kenya he was sort of...
Yeah, he was withdrawn. He wasn't himself. Yeah. I think he was...
Was that deliberate?
No, he was avoiding injuries, I think. Because, you see, for Kenya, Mo Salah, we were looking at Mo Salah. Every defender was looking at how to stop Mo Salah. And him being an international star, he knew their chances of qualification were very high. He's not going to get an injury, maybe because of that game. Because you look at his performance against Kenya was slow, sluggish. It's as if he's in the game, he's not in the game. He was not himself. So I think he was just taking it easy. And you look at Aubameyang also, he didn't stand out in the international games that have been played. So he has a chance now today to prove himself. He's given that chance. Because while he was away, others stepped up. While he didn't play, Lacazette stepped up and performed. Saka stepped up and performed. You see, that's the problem that he has now. So he has to prove to his manager that I'm still up to the task. So give me this chance to do it.
Laced up against Manchester City, that is also a good game.
Yeah.
Can the two, Iheanacho and Vardy, continue with their heroic exploits up front and frustrate City?
Yeah, I think you look at City, they always have problems with teams that have speed on the counter, you know. Teams like United can beat City effortlessly, just playing the way they play. And Leicester also have that thing under their knee because Vardy is a really fast and really clinical player. So it's going to be a really great game because City, they don't play any different each game, you know. They go into games looking to destroy teams and play out themselves. And Leicester, I think it has really good players, especially in the midfield. Ndidi and Tielemans are the best partnership in the midfield we've seen at Leicester. I think in the Premier League right now, having those two in the midfield, it is a really great partnership because Tielemans has a great pass and Didi wins like almost every other ball, you know. He gets the ball quickly, Tielemans sets it up forward to Vardy, boom, that's it. So that's going to be a really crunch game, you know. City don't want to lose, Leicester want to maintain their position above United. So looking at that, I think it's going to be a lot, there are going to be a lot of goals like their first meeting.
Big shout out to Oprah Kiki, who is watching. A Man United diehard, I know. She's equally looking forward to United victory against Brighton.
Brighton, yeah.
They are called nowadays Kiburi FC.
Yeah.
I'm a Kiburi Leash, and coincidentally, I'm interviewing two United fans who are so much, you know, arrogant. Since they started being second on the table, they think that they have won the league.
But now, we are the best among the rest, not second.
Yeah.
We are the best among the rest.
Europa League?
We have very great chances of winning it, and Solskjaer will not have an excuse of not winning it because we've been given Granada. I think we can go past Granada, and after that we may face either Roma or Ajax. Ajax, we've beaten them before. Roma, we've beaten them 7 at one given time.
Yeah.
So I think we can go all the way to the final. I had some Arsenal fans saying they are waiting for us in the final. The question is that will they make it to the final? Because Manchester United will definitely go to the final.
I was forgetting that those Chelsea fans equally think that they can win the league going to their recent high flying form. No, Premier League title right now as we speak, playing against West Bromwich Albion, and currently they have just scored a goal. I don't know who has scored, but I'm checking for you. Christian Pulisic has scored a goal against West Bromwich Albion. So far, 28 minutes have been played. Of course, later on, Leeds will be playing host to Sheffield United. Leicester playing host to Manchester City at 7:30 p.m. Then Liverpool visiting Arsenal at the Emirates at 10 p.m. I don't know, your parting shots, your final words?
I think let's look forward to a great weekend of football, because the Premier League is back. The Bundesliga is here. There's Bayern Munich versus Leipzig. There's the Clásico coming. And then there's the Champions League week. So we are grateful that club football is finally back. It's going to be a great week ahead of football for fans, and fans whose teams are not in the Champions League. We can enjoy other teams' failures. I mean, Liverpool. But it's okay. Let's walk into the week and see how it goes.
And you know, Ken has been on the show. He's been a guest, a co-host this particular afternoon from 1 p.m. And Ken, if you think you've exhausted your points, I'm just being told by the director that we have 8 minutes extra. So we need to preview what's coming up. So Chelsea under Tuchel, they look like, man, they're rejuvenated.
They're solid. They're solid because Tuchel has come in and has assisted Chelsea to keep the ball. You see, they keep the ball from the opponent. Yeah. The problem they've been having is precision. So you find that they're scoring 1-0, 2-1. You see, with the talent, if you look at the attacking talent or the attacking prowess that Chelsea has, they should be beating teams 4-0, 5-0. Mm-hmm. And that is what now Tuchel has to work on it. And but their solidness, and they have kept a lot of clean sheets since he came in. The reason why they are doing that, Tuchel is now playing each player in his favorite position. Mm-hmm. He's not playing Kante out of position. Kante is playing where he knows best. Destroying those moves, breaking up play, and winning balls. You see, Lampard could play him on the left, sometimes on the right, you see, and that could affect the balance of the team. Tuchel is now playing everybody in his position. He's rotating the front players, but he has to really work on Timo Werner's confidence.
Yeah.
And for him to be able to score, I saw him missing a sitter against Germany. And when Tuchel was asked, he said that even if when you want to win a girl over and you ask her out and she refuses, you sit back and wait, she will come. So he's trying to tell Timo Werner to avoid being anxious, to wait for the goals will come.
Quite an update coming from Stamford Bridge. Chelsea's blow as Thiago Silva gets red carded on 30th minute against West Bromwich Albion. They're leading so far, and it's high time West Bromwich capitalizes on the same to mount a comeback and, if possible, record a win. Big Sam hasn't been quite convincing since he took charge. Yeah. Most of us thought that he was coming to rescue West Brom from relegation, but as it looks like, things are shaky for him, right?
Yeah, I think they are going down whatever results they get in the coming games. I think when they will have salvaged the season, that time is long gone now. Now they should just look at themselves, what their plans for next season, and also Big Sam, he hasn't done what he usually does, because you look at the defensive record with him and you look at his defensive record at other clubs where he's managed to keep them up. This one is really dismal. It's really the worst of Big Sam's career. And for Chelsea, they've just conceded, I think, still with 10 men. They have 10 players, but 10 world-class players on the pitch. West Brom do not have that. So if they lose this game, it will be bad for them, because they're also chasing Champions League football in the top four qualification. And also the other teams below them are serious. West Ham, Everton, they want to get into the top four. So they should really do something.
So what will be happening in the midweek? Tuesday, two games, big games. Manchester City up against Dortmund, then Real Madrid against Liverpool.
Yeah, two really big games. But
where did Jadon Sancho go?
He's still there. He's still there.
I think the thing is, maybe when he didn't get his move to United, you know, it's a lot of money and everything. Maybe he lost himself somewhere there, but he's been performing okay. Yeah, I've seen some great performances from him still, and I think he's going through an injury right now. I saw him recovering. And for Dortmund, I think the team in general has been poor this season. Yeah, their forward players have been scoring, but they are scoring while conceding. They score one, they concede two. So it's not really a great place to be for them right now. And it's a lot of young players, and you know their confidence is easily taken apart. So you need to understand Dortmund, yeah? I would have much words for Sancho because we know there's a great player in there. We've seen him, we've seen Haaland, Bellingham. They're all great players. And City know they're young, so Pep will try to absolutely take them apart. And also, Real versus Liverpool, the key thing is that Sergio Ramos is injured because looking back at...
You saw what he wrote about Mo Salah, right? He likes the shoulder.
But despite the fact that Sergio Ramos is injured, yeah. They have a specialist in Zinedine Zidane, yeah, when it comes to the Champions League. Mm. He has a way of setting up his team. I saw how he set up his team against Atalanta.
Yeah.
When Atalanta was being hyped as to be the ones who will knock out Real Madrid, yeah, he came out in the second leg and did wonders.
Yeah.
So again here, we are looking at that masterclass coming from him. But generally, if you look at the Real Madrid squad, it's not a great squad. It's not a squad that we know.
Average or slightly above average?
Slightly above average. Because they have also key players who are aging. Luka Modric,
Karim Benzema,
Toni Kroos, who are in their 30s. And you find that despite that, they are able to perform. I saw Luka Modric against Atalanta. He put in a great show, despite being 33 or 34.
Yeah.
So he still has that. So we'll have two aging squads meeting, because they have also Liverpool on the other side, where their players are also aging. But now the challenge for Liverpool will be they play a big game against Arsenal today, and then they want to play a big game in the midweek. That one will take a toll on them.
Yeah.
When you look at the fixture against Man City and Dortmund, Jadon Sancho had problems with injuries, and then this season he was overshadowed by Haaland.
Yeah.
Everything right now, if you go to them, we are talking about Haaland. Last season, we were talking about Sancho. And I think for Manchester United, it's a big plus, because if they still go in for him in the summer, they'll get him at a cheaper price.
Yeah.
But now coming to their game, I think they'll give Man City a run for their money, but Man City eventually will run away with the points because of Pep Guardiola. And that depends on what team Pep Guardiola presents, because he's also known to overthink. Mm. To overthink and overtinker with the squad. Eh? So that one is also 50-50.
Mm.
But it will be an interesting game, because we have two teams that keep the ball.
Yeah.
Two teams that play the ball. And it will be a very open game with quite a number of goals.
Two teams who like scoring, they usually get a lot.
So I think whoever did the pairing for UEFA Champions League did want to entertain us, because all the four pairings are, you know, quite scintillating matches. Chelsea up against Porto on Wednesday, and to be preceded by another crunch game, beating Bayern Munich against French Moneybags Paris Saint-Germain, and those are title favorites for UEFA Champions League. Where do you place your money? Bavarians against PSG.
Lewandowski is out.
No, even though he's out, no, Bayern, like, they're
ruthless.
I think it will be a big game for Pochettino.
Yes.
Because now Pochettino, it will be a point for him to prove himself.
Mm.
He has a world class players in Mbappe. He has world class players in Neymar. PSG. Neymar, I don't know if he'll be fit. He's 50-50. He has been battling an injury.
Besides Mbappe, who is world class player at PSG?
Aquinos.
Verratti.
Marco.
And the keeper.
Keylor Navas. He has quite a number of good players. And then he has also...
I was forgetting they have Neymar.
He has also very hard-working players like under Herrera. Herrera, who will fight for the team, who will die for the team.
Yeah.
And you look at he was able to win.
Is he guaranteed of a first-team start?
He's been playing. Eh? Yeah. And Pochettino was able to knock out Barcelona without Neymar in both legs. And it is his opportunity to prove himself.
Yeah.
Because what he's capable of doing.
Yes, he's been being accused that he cannot win any trophy. Now here you have a good team. Now go ahead and win.
Chelsea up against Porto. Can Tuchel replicate the same glittering show he's put in Premier League, in continental elite club competition?
Yeah. I think Chelsea are the favorites to go against Porto, but Juve are also the favorites to beat Porto. And we saw what Porto did, you know, a great defensive team. They set themselves up well defensively, a little bit like Atletico, but, you know, they have hard-working players. You know, they know they're the underdogs, so we have to give 110. And that's always a hard match with people who know we are supposed to lose this game, but we as players don't want to lose. So I think Chelsea will go through, honestly, but you never know, you know. It can happen the same way it happened to Juventus. Just like that, you're out.
The crunch tie happening. Both supporters are very optimistic that they will win. My friend Murira Kinoti, Director General of Kura, is very hopeful that, you know, Arsenal will pull a surprise. Despite odds not being in their favor, they can mount what they are capable of doing, especially going by what they have done previously against heavyweights to record a much-needed victory against Liverpool tonight. While David Masanga, chair of an African Forum, also telling me that he started being a supporter of Liverpool ages back and is hopeful that despite their poor run, in absence of their influential players, they can pull this one through against Arsenal. Let's see what will happen. Touchline Y25 is the hashtag at Y254 channel. To Asike Maxwell, let's continue with the conversation. Be part of the program because a lot is happening in terms of European football. Leagues are back after international break and football is back, what we all passionate about, despite the fact that, you know, President Uhuru Kenyatta put in place stringent measures that suspended sporting activities. We can comfortably watch, you know, club football at the comforts of our houses. Anyway, it's been a pleasure doing this from 1 to 3 again next Saturday, same time, same place. Rico, thanks for coming through. Thank you for your insights.
Thank you so much.
And Ken also, thank you for coming through, and it's been, you know, a pleasure doing this with you from 1 to 3. God bless you. Keep safe. Continue, you know, observing containment measures put in place by the government as we seek to combat this monster. To our technical crew who have been, you know, contributed to the success of this show, big up and God bless.